They say you've made it when you're in the big bright lights. The scary thing about those big bright lights is they're sometimes blinding. Candia Consulting presents Beyond the Bright Lights Podcast.
Welcome everyone to another episode of Beyond the Bright Lights with the Candias. I'm Deon.
And I'm Michelle.
And we are excited because this is episode number 5.
Number 5.
We have a very, very special guest. I don't even want to say guest, but
yes,
a good friend of ours.
Sister,
that we
family,
know for a long time.
All that stuff.
And it's a privilege to have her here with us to be able to talk about not just what she is a professional in, but about her life.
Yes.
So we have the one, the only, Miss Tamecka Dixon.
I knew she was beautiful with that Michelle name going on. She had to be all of that.
Yeah, you should have seen her. When she was typing in your name, she was like, oh, her name is Michelle.
I was like, all right.
That's right.
Calm down.
Hey, let me tell you.
Yeah. So what's been up?
Oh, man, just living life.
Yeah.
Every day getting better.
Good.
Yeah. Well, for those of you who don't know some of Tamecka's accolades, and these are just a few because my hand would have been just tired typing all of the accolades that this young lady has had. Tamecka went to my alma mater and my husband Deon's alma mater, which was Linden High School. All-American by the WBCA, Women's Basketball Coaching Association. Participated in the WBCA High School All-American Game in 1993. Scored 1,000 points at Linden High School. Now, were you the only young lady?
Actually, I scored 2,000 points.
Oh,
you can't mess that up.
Hello?
I believe I'm the only person.
All right. We're going to get it popping.
We're going to get
it popping just like that, okay?
There ain't too many people in high school that do that, period.
Yeah. So we're going to hand clap on that one right there.
Absolutely.
Played for the University of Kansas 1993 to 1997. Was named the Big 12 Player of the Year in 1997, and was also named to the 1996-1997 Kodak All-American team. You're in the Basketball Hall of Fame for the University of Kansas. Had your jersey retired at Kansas in 2003?
Yes.
We gonna have some conversation about retiring jerseys.
Yes.
Okay, we wanna have a little conversation about that, okay? In 2002, you were named to the national team, which competed in World Championship in I can't pronounce these places in China.
Yes.
I'm not going to do you any injustice, China. Let me just leave that alone. You were selected in the first round of the 1997 WNBA draft by the Los Angeles Sparks. First ever draft for the WNBA?
Yes.
Mm. All right, all right. And you won two championships rings, each coming from, let's see, wins with the Sparks 2001 and 2002.
Yep.
You played for the Los Angeles Sparks, Houston Comets, and the Indian Fever before retiring in 2009?
Actually.
At the end of 2009 season?
Well, 2009 is when I finished in LA. Then I moved to Houston, played 3 years with them. So I actually officially retired in 2012.
Okay, okay. Wow. And then you went and you played across seas in Italy,
yes.
Correct?
Yep,
okay.
Absolutely.
So three-time WNBA All-Star, 2001 to 2003.
Mm-hmm.
Two-time WNBA champion. And all WNBA second team 2001.
Yep. That's
okay. Cool. That's all I got. I can't.
And it was also something else. But hold up, you had a little role in a movie too, right?
Yeah. Actually, that was a couple of roles.
All right. What's a couple of roles?
So I was in Love and Basketball.
Okay.
And then I also was a stunt double. And what was it? Oh goodness gracious! It was actually. Oh, it's a scary movie. Scary movie.
What?
I was a stunt double for one of the girls when they did the, you remember the Nike commercials with the dribble?
Oh, yeah.
So they did like a spoof.
Yeah,
Movie. And they had a girl doing it. I was actually the dribbler.
I remember that part.
And they had her
face on. I didn't know that.
So I was a stunt double.
Look at that.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Nigga, that is awesome. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, it was cool.
That is crazy.
It was cool.
Wow. So talk a little bit about your upbringing when you had the basketball in your hand, put your hand the first time. How did that happen?
I think where I developed my love for the game is with my father.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up, all my early memories were with him. So I remember, as early as I can remember is maybe like 5 years old, but even before that, you know, he would have me around, you know, the game. My father and mother had me at 17, so
okay.
My dad was still in high school. My mom and dad were still in high school, seniors in high school.
Wow.
And then when my father got his college scholarship at American, he would come home during his breaks, and he would just have me in the gym with him. So, like, I can kind of remember some of that stuff, and I think that was where I developed kind of my love.
Okay.
Maybe not for the game, but just wanting to, you know, that's where I developed my bond as far as far as being that bond with my father.
Yeah,
And then wanting to be and do everything that he did.
Exactly.
So, right. You know, it kind of went hand in hand then.
Okay, now was your mom an athlete as well, or?
If you talk to her, if you ask her, she's the reason my father got
So she's taking her credit. She's like, listen.
Yeah, she's like, I was in the gym with him. And I was, if you talk to her, she'll say that. But she really, she was, you know, tall, about, 5'10", 5'9", 5'10", so taller. You know, she had some, athletic skill sets, she wasn't really an athlete. My father, I think, is where I developed that part of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's deep. So tell me just a little bit more about your childhood period. Just what was Mika's childhood like? What siblings, household?
It was awesome. I was the only child for 13 years.
So basically,
my whole childhood growing up, I was by myself. I was an only child. Not really by myself because I had from a huge family on both sides. So like my first and second cousins were like brothers and sisters.
Okay.
We grew up really close. But I had an awesome childhood. My father early on wasn't really present because he was playing. I wouldn't say wasn't really present. I would say he was gone a lot because he was in college. So I remember, being young and traveling. He played at American in D.C.
Okay.
So I remember, actually traveling to his games and stuff very young. And then when he finished his college career, he was a draft pick in the NBA, but he had some injuries and stuff like that. Okay. So he didn't stick, but then he went overseas and played in Argentina and Italy, France. And
nice.
So I was able to experience some of those moments with him.
Okay.
So my childhood was incredible.
Mm-hmm,
I grew up with, you know, just love on both sides of my family. And they've always, like, I got the support from everybody.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, they didn't say, you know, you're a girl, so you should do this.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you know, it was kind of like, even as a young age, I kind of gravitated towards sports.
Mm-hmm.
I was always athletic.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And my mom, I think early on, she might have, like, tried to, I never really liked wearing, wasn't a girly girl.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She tried to do that
right
early on,
right.
But she figured out early, okay, all right,
it's gonna work.
After Easter, we go to church on Sunday, I know you want to get out to dress and go that's just the kind of, you know, so she kind of, you know, she embraced that and supported that.
Okay.
And I think that was a big reason why, you know, I was able to be successful later on.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yep.
Mm.
Wow.
At the younger years, what would you think, what was the most, who had the most influence on you other than your father? Because obviously to make it to that level, you have a lot of coaches, you have a lot of mentors, you have a lot of people. But besides your father, who else was there to help guide you and make sure that you were on the right path?
My mom and then my grandparents
were
instrumental. I, growing up, lived a lot of my years with both my grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
And I think just like the subtle things that they would do kind of shaped who I am, you know, like both of them were, neither one of my mom's father, I never knew.
Okay.
He passed before I was born. He passed when my mom was little.
Okay.
And then my father's father was kind of, he was out of the house, and my grandmother on that side remarried.
Okay.
But there was a period of time where I just seen like the strong woman, like kind of that dynamic, because there was no father present. And just having, you know, I think just the stability from seeing that, like I just grew up seeing that and just seeing how strong and independent I needed to be, whether I was in a relationship later on with or with a man or not, you know, and the feeling that I can still accomplish the things I wanted to accomplish, because they were so strong in their spot. But I got that from my grandmothers. They ruled with an iron fist on both sides. And so, you know, you seen that, just that strength from them. And then it kind of came all the way down. You know, my father, you know, got it from my mom or my grandma, and then it just kind of went, you know, trickled down into us, you know, the grands and stuff like that. But I think when you think about role models growing up, I think, you know, my grandmothers were and still are.
Right.
Still have one left. One passed away some years ago, but, you know, just what they instilled in me, man, incredible. Incredible.
Wow. So when you talk about that with the grandmothers and just your father being away, you had your grandmothers and your grandmother remarried, what was your relationship like, maybe not seeing a lot of men in the household at the time? Do you think that had any type of impact on you throughout the years when you got older? Just anything at all, do you think that?
I really don't think it did, only because, you know, when I grew up, like I had my father was present. So for me, you know, it really didn't bother me that way.
Okay.
But I think, you know, just growing up, or not growing up, but thinking about it later, like, you know, just looking upon it, you know, I have younger siblings now. And I have one younger sibling that I'm extremely close to. His father wasn't present.
Okay.
And so you think about all the things that he grew up having to endure, and I can see how, you know, it affected him, you know, growing up. But for me personally, I don't feel I had that because I had my village.
Okay.
Was so strong around me,
that's,
you know.
That's huge.
If it wasn't, you know, my great grandfathers or my grandfather, I just had cousins and uncles, and, you know, they took on, you know, certain roles, and, you know, my village was just that strong where it didn't affect me, you know, to a certain extent.
Okay, okay. So let's talk a little bit about when it was that you feel like it clicked for you that basketball was going to be something that you would want to pursue.
It clicked for me pretty early, but I think my parents kind of wanted me to do other things, never shunned me from doing other things. I knew where my love was. I was like, I want to play basketball, and that's all I want to do. But I remember growing up, you know, I played softball, I ran track. Like, I was well-rounded as far as sports go. So I played all of it, but I knew where my love was. And probably my freshman year in high school is where I kind of like said, okay, like I want to take this serious and move forward with just this. But like my parents were supportive and was like, well, maybe you should try, you know, keep playing it, because I was pretty decent at like everything I
athletic,
picked up.
Yeah.
I was just athletic.
Yeah. Did you feel a pressure of going to basketball?
I didn't feel a pressure at all, and everybody asked me that because my father, you know, growing up, you know, my everybody was like, oh, that's Boo's daughter, that's Boo's daughter. You know, everybody, that was my identity.
Right.
So they kind of thought that's what I was going to do anyway.
Yeah,
but there
yeah.
was no pressure from my parents, you know, for me to do that.
And that's different. You know? It's hard for a kid, too, because I played ball, and my son, we were away in Massachusetts, so we come back, he didn't know like the caliber that I played at.
Yeah.
And then I ran track, so I was fast too.
Yeah.
So when he started meeting my friends and stuff, everybody was like, you gonna play ball?
Yeah.
Are you fast?
Yeah.
And he wasn't really as fast, but they was like, so he was just like, I feel like I gotta play. I gotta, you know what I'm saying? So it's a lot of times,
you
know, to reach, you know, where your parents are, you feel that.
Yeah.
You feel like, you know, I'll be a disappointment if I didn't do what people expect me to do.
Absolutely.
You know,
and I think, and I think my siblings kind of got that. Because then I blazed my own trail.
Right, right.
And then after me, you know, I have two brothers and a sister.
Okay.
And I think everybody was looking at them like,
you set the bar.
Yeah. Like, what y'all gonna do?
She was all American. She did that. You know, they like, yeah, what y'all gonna bring to the table?
So I think they kind of got that pressure. And I asked, you know, years later, like, you know, one of them, like my brother Derek, I said, did you feel pressure, you know, coming up behind me? And it was like, you know, and I was like, man, I never really thought about
it.
Because I didn't feel it.
Right.
And I guess it's because I kind of, I've reached like a certain amount of success.
Absolutely.
You know.
Absolutely.
But it wasn't really any pressure for me, but I guess for them, having to follow that was crazy.
Right, right. So getting into the basketball scene in high school, you know, you started doing really well.
Yeah.
What were some of the schools that started, you know, showing interest in you?
Oh, man. That was crazy.
Well, I should say who didn't show interest.
It was, I remember.
But some of the bigger schools that you, like, you know what I'm saying? Because you go from one point where you're like, wow, I'm watching all these universities on TV and stuff.
Yeah.
But then they're interested in me. So what were some of the schools that you were just like, wow?
Yeah, I'll share a little story about that, too, because I remember I was a sophomore in high school. And the AAU scene, AAU basketball scene, was just starting to become like prominent for high school basketball. And I was playing with a team called the Monarchs, New Jersey Monarchs. Back then, now it's not like that, but back then you would play in a tournament in the state and you had to qualify to go to nationals by being either the one or the two, the first or the second ranked team out of the state to get out. Now it's like 1,000 AAU teams in New Jersey and
so
everybody's
many
playing.
So many ways to qualify.
Oh my God.
It was like that. It was so much more competitive back then. And you had to have a squad.
Right, right.
So we qualified for nationals, and then my first national tournament was in Clovis, New Mexico. I was a sophomore in high school.
Wow.
Flew out there, and I remember the second day there, because we had played, you know, all you do is play nonstop. Like, I played like 4 or 5 games the first 2 games, our first 2 days, excuse me. And then I called home to check in, and my father was like, "What are you doing down there?"
Mm.
Like, people been calling this house.
While you were there?
While I was there.
Wow.
And that was like my first introduction to, you know, being recruited by colleges. Because prior to that, you know, I got a few letters here and there, you know, from local schools.
Yeah, but it was that exposure.
But it was that exposure.
Yeah,
I mean, everybody.
Competition that was there.
Everybody was there, and it was all the top talent, because you were playing against the top 2 teams from other states. So it was like all the top talent out in those tournaments. And yeah, and that's when it all hit the fan. It was crazy when I got back, and it was like nonstop. But it was like all the top schools, the Connecticuts, the Tennessees, I mean, everybody. Because I was over 200 schools.
What?
That was something.
It was crazy.
Deep.
Yeah. So how did you narrow down to Kansas? How did you know you wanted to? There's not a lot to do in Kansas.
Not a lot to do at all. I had 30 home visits.
Wow.
30. And my father and mother and my village was sitting on those home visits, and you know, we narrowed that down to 10. And we had to narrow the 10 down to 5, because you only could take 5 campus visits. So I didn't do anything local, because I figured we can drive.
Rutgers,
we can do all that.
Right.
I had criteria. You know, even as a high school, I wanted to play for a black coach. That was important to me. So, at like 4 of the 5 home visits I took were all black coaches. I felt it was important to me even back then. And then, you know, from the 5 campus visits, I chose Kansas. And of course, it was a black coach, but I mean, it was way more than that. And I chose Kansas from the 5 campus visit. But actually, before I even left there, I knew where I wanted to go, but you kind of got to go through the process.
Right.
You know, I was like, maybe I'll change my mind or whatever. And it didn't change. I knew that's where I wanted to be.
Wow.
And it was easy once I got on campus and I met with the girls hung out with them for a weekend, and it was just an energy and a vibe.
Wow.
And I knew that's where I belong. So that was it.
And how was that transition from high school and when you finally got to campus, the whole basketball and, you know, because you were like, you know, the big fish.
Yeah.
And then when you get there, you're just like,
you the small fish.
They can ball here.
Yeah.
A fish.
You back to the yes. You a guppy. You got to start over.
Yeah.
I'll never forget, you know. And I had kind of like a little ego,
because
I was an All-American. I could play with these girls.
Yeah,
and
they should know who I am.
I remember first preseason conditioning training, we all came together and we played a little bit before we got into our conditioning and stuff. And I remember, usually I can get to the hole real easy. Got in there, and Lisa Tate, she was the center at the time, threw my stuff across the
wall.
And she was like, welcome, freshman.
It ain't gonna be easy.
And I was like, it's all right. You know, it's a new day. It's not gonna be easy, but it was definitely a transition.
Wow.
Definitely a transition.
When you think about just backing up a little bit in high school, and you're in the 10th grade, you get all these letters and everything, and just you saying you had a little ego. When you're in high school, you're young, you're 15 or whatever the age, 16 years old, and you get all this attention.
Yeah.
How do you think you navigated? Or did you think, I didn't navigate that great through it, or, you know, I had to be humbled in some areas over here, or how do you do it? Because that's a lot.
It was a lot. It really was a lot. And then, you know, and then it was all the intangibles that came with that. You know, like, you know, like the coaches would just pop up at our practices, or I'm coming out of math and I would see one of the coaches coming through the hallway, like, what are you doing here?
You know what I mean?
It was just, it was crazy. It was a lot to deal with, and it was something that I didn't want to deal with. Like, I just wanted to be, you know, a high school athlete. Enjoy my high school experience. And I think when you're, you have like an elite status as far as from an athletic perspective, you forced to grow up pretty quick because you're dealing with so much more than just your grades and, you know, just enjoying that high school experience. So yeah, it was, I tried to kind of like not deal with it as much and tried to kind of have that high school experience, but it was there and it was something that obviously you have to, you know, kind of navigate through. But I took it day by day. I probably made some mistakes, and probably if I had to do it all over again, there's some things that maybe I would change. But you know, as a 15-year-old, 16-year-old kid, it's like, you know, you're just trying to make it through.
You're
just trying to navigate.
Because I'm thinking of just an adult. With all of that attention. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, when you're 15 or whatever, you don't quite have the same maturity level as someone that's been around a little longer. But you look at some of the adults, they get all that attention, and they lose their mind. Right.
Think about social media. Like, I couldn't even think about all of that, and then having the social social media aspect come into play as well.
Exactly.
It's crazy.
And you see that today with the young athletes.
Yeah.
They have all of that. They have, you know, the fact that they're in school and they have all this attention. Then they have Twitter followers, you know, Instagram, Facebook. They have, well, Facebook's kind of for the old folks, but Instagram and Twitter, they have all of this following.
Everything.
So it's like, I'm thinking, I'm guessing it's up to the parents to make sure that they stay level-headed, because everybody else around them is saying, you are that guy, or you are that girl. You know
what
I'm saying?
Absolutely right.
So it's just like, it's intense, and it's a lot to have to deal with.
And your village, man, I talk about the village. Your village got to be present through all of that. Otherwise, it's easy to get swept away in all that hype.
Yeah. Do you think that was an advantage, your father knowing what to expect and just kind of like really, because a lot of times the kids now, they don't have that. They don't know, you know, being a coach at home, they don't know like the certain things they should be doing, shouldn't be doing, the discipline that it takes. You know, I'm just helping this young man get recruited, and I go on his social media and I'm just like, hold up, these guys about to go on your social media. I said, you can't have this, you can't have that. What were you at doing this? Why are you talking like that? I said, they won't even, they just will stop responding to you. You won't even know why, but you know, you need that foundation, people leading you and telling you like, this is what you need to do. Because sometimes I'm sure, you know, being an athlete, it got lonely.
Oh yeah.
Because you gotta get to the gym and everybody having fun.
Going to the party or whatever it is on.
Even in high school, you know, I can remember missing a lot of things. You know, because I, at an early age, kind of figured out that this is what I want to do. This is where I want to be. And I had the blueprint because I looked at my father from, if I need to do this and I want to get there, I got to follow how So a lot of times there were a lot of things that, you know, a lot of parties and a lot of things that I missed. It sacrificed a lot, but I mean, the payoff in the end was incredible.
Right,
you know,
right.
Incredible. So I don't regret anything.
So when you get to college and you with all these other great athletes and great players, what do you think it was in college that made you say, you know what? I want to pursue this. I don't know if they're going to have anything for women, but I want to be my absolute best. Was there talkings at the time while you were in college to know that there was a possibility of a WNBA? What was that like?
Great question. So when I was, well, the woman that recruited me, my junior year in college, she left. She took the director of player personnel job for the WNBA. That's when I knew that it was going to become a reality. But before that, even then, there was also, which a lot of people don't know, there was another professional women's league already in existence. It was called the ABL. Mm. It was called the American Basketball League.
Okay.
And so it was in existence my junior year. Mm-hmm. It was out a little bit sooner than the WNBA. And it was backed by some pretty good, you know, some pretty good people. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I knew that as early as my junior year in high school that I would have an opportunity to possibly pursue this professionally. But I kind of loved the idea that the backing of the WNBA was the NBA.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I was like, man, with that, you got mm-hmm. staying power. Mm-hmm. You know. So it was nice to be coming out of college and then have a choice mm-hmm. as the mm-hmm. Wood League. And a lot of the seniors coming out at the time had an option mm-hmm. of which league they wanted to play in mm-hmm. if that league pursued them. Mm-hmm. And that was my situation. I could have went, you know, the ABL at the time, coming out was playing six figures right away.
Wow.
For rookies.
Wow. Yeah.
So I was
wow.
like, oh, you know, the money was there.
Right, yeah.
The WNBA, the contracts weren't as good starting out, but you knew that the WNBA
right.
kind of
had
that staying power, yeah. and if you stayed in it long enough, you would be able to reap the benefits by, you know, being there.
Okay.
So I did, you know, obviously I chose the WNBA, and the ABL kind of, it folded maybe 5 years in.
Wow.
5 or 6 years
Woo.
In. Yeah, so a lot of those girls mm-hmm. actually started coming in, which is what should have happened anyway.
Right, right, right.
Once you had that mixing of the two leagues, you had all the best players.
Yeah,
in
yeah.
league,
yeah, very competitive.
Instead of separating.
Absolutely.
Right, so yeah, right. but it was a good time.
That was a wise decision.
Absolutely.
Because I don't regret it. I know you don't. Because I didn't hear of the ABL, nor did I hear of a drafting of the players or mm-hmm. anything like that. Mm-hmm. I remember the WNBA, that was you.
Yeah.
You know
yeah.
what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when you talk, just going on into that, was the draft for the WNBA anything like for the men?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was. My experience at the time, they the same thing like the men. They invited mm-hmm. the top players. Mm-hmm. Now, the first draft was a little different mm-hmm. than what you would see now mm-hmm. because you had us coming out of college, mm-hmm. so you had the seniors, the mm-hmm. college seniors. Mm-hmm. But then you had the players that were dying to get back into the States to mm-hmm. play, that have been playing overseas for 5, 6, 7, 10 years.
Right,
and now
right.
they like, it's a league here.
Yeah,
in America.
Yeah.
I'm coming
yeah.
home.
Yeah.
So you had a pool of international players, well, international American players
right, right,
coming
right.
back. So for us as college seniors, we really had to compete against like
yeah.
experienced players.
Yeah,
we
yeah,
like we just coming
yeah.
out of college. You know, so even though I was the 14th overall pick, I was the third college player pick. So if it was in the traditional draft yeah. now, I would have been the third overall pick.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Right, right.
Potentially.
Right.
But I don't regret anything. Mm-hmm, like mm-hmm. I said, it was a pool of players, and I was kind of thrown in that pool with mm-hmm. all those players.
Mm-hmm.
And it was cool. You had every franchise team had, they were able to pick from their dream draft. So they had two players that they would build their league their team from. So ours was, we had Lisa Leslie.
Mm-hmm,
she
mm-hmm.
was our anchor player. And then we had Penny Toler. And then they had some other players, Deidre Charles, like ballers.
Yeah, mm. yeah.
You know what I mean? And then they were trying to build their roster out from the draft.
Wow.
So what was that experience?
Oh, it was cool.
You was,
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Like,
that's
it.
That's not your everyday experience,
yeah,
okay,
yeah,
Meek?
I was one of the seniors that they selected.
Mm-hmm.
They flew in maybe like 40, I think it was, seniors.
Okay.
To come back and experience the draft. And it was nerve-wracking.
Mm.
Really, it was. You're sitting in a room and you're waiting for I'm with my parents.
Mm-hmm.
And,
wow.
You know, you're waiting for, you don't know until
right.
you actually
yeah.
get that, you know, looking at the draft, the
right,
NFL
right.
draft now, until you get that call.
Yeah, yeah. yeah
you
yeah.
just sitting in there, you got everybody wow. getting up and going, leaving the green room, and you still sitting there
right,
like,
right.
man,
yeah.
you know. But the first draft was in Secaucus. Okay. It was at the NBA studios.
Okay.
In Secaucus, and I remember just being in the green room, just nervous.
Wow.
Like, I knew I was going to get, you know.
Yeah.
You didn't want to be the person that they invited you in and your number
the cameras
got
or whatever in your face and you like.
We've seen
too,
some of that.
Day two.
We've seen that with the
You don't want to be that person. You like, dang. You know. So, but yeah, I was thankful, you know, that my number was called 14th. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I got the, stood up with Val Ackerman, the president, had the jersey and
that was historical nice. Because the league had just started.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So
crazy.
Then you moved to LA?
Mm-hmm.
How was that?
Oh,
moving to LA.
Yeah.
That's like on another, we've been there and it's like LA is like you can't really describe it.
It's
just
LA.
Like
we just went
put
to
on
San
the West Coast.
Yeah, we
period.
Went to the West Coast.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
I
that whole
LA.
Experience for you. Cause you went, you know, obviously around this area.
Yeah.
Right. To Kansas. Yeah. Right. I did from Kansas to LA.
Dorothy went to LA.
Yeah.
She left Kansas.
And just imagine, it's like I still felt like I was a child,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm,
20,
mm-hmm.
21 years old, and it's like, okay, now you got to pack your bags and you going to LA, and it's like, it was like a kid in the candy store, you know, it was like, what better, I couldn't be in a better situation.
Right, right, right.
Really, I couldn't, you know, the league was supportive, the franchise was supportive of us, and you know, they opened their doors immediately and embraced me, you know, embraced me for 9 years in LA. And I have so many stories about just being a rookie in LA and, you know, all the things you're exposed to and all the perks and everything that came
with
just being, you know, in the WNBA and being on that scene. And, you know, there were worse places. I didn't want to be in New York. Like, I did not want them to draft me. I was like, please don't draft me. Because I got, like, so much family out here.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's a lot
and
of
my hassle. My hassle would have been, how am I getting tickets for y'all? Y'all going to have to pay for these
Come
tickets.
On now. Come on now. Come on now.
Yeah.
So I didn't really want to be close to home.
Right, I get it. I totally get that.
So I was the furthest I could have possibly
been. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but it was amazing.
So you step on the floor out there. Mm-hmm. Now, was this considered, since you were in L.A., would you be considered a sister team to the other, to the, you know, like to the Lakers or
Absolutely.
To the Clippers or whatever?
Yep.
So
the Lakers were actually our brothers.
Okay.
The team was owned by Dr. Buss, who was the owner. Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes.
So we, you know, and they were very hands-on.
Mm.
Very hands-on. Very hands-on. Johnny Buss, who was Dr. Buss's son.
Okay.
Was our president.
Mm.
So it was a family, like a family orientated. We did everything the Lakers did. We practiced in the Lakers facility.
Wow.
You know, at the time we were in the Forum, you know, where the Lakers played, and then later we moved to the Staples Center.
Wow.
So it was, you know, they didn't spare any calls.
Right, right, right. It wasn't
us.
Like, well, they the WNBA,
they were supportive,
like
they were behind it, they pushed it. The first game was crazy.
Mm. Mm.
Denzel, Tyra Banks. I was like, all these people are not really here to watch me play, are they? You know, it was kind of like, I was starstruck.
Yeah, I was, because I was like,
this is
amazing. But how could you not be?
Yeah, this is
right,
this
right.
wasn't the norm that you grew up around.
Absolutely.
Right. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
You was like, wait a minute, I'm just a basketball player with some gifts and some talents and some skills, and I'm here amongst these people who've been doing this for years, and they're here to watch me compete.
First game, it was crazy. It was like the who's who.
Wow.
You know, and it was... We packed it out, you know, it was 19,000 people for our first game.
Mm.
We played against New York.
Mm-hmm.
It was on national television.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like those experiences, man, was incredible. And to see how far it's come, you know, since day one.
Right,
and
right.
And to be a part of it.
Right,
know,
right.
Day one,
yes,
to see the transition and the progression. Crazy, but it was an exciting time, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, you being a woman going into this league, and you see the young men going into the league and some of the pitfalls and the traps and, you know, not having really good mentoring, getting themselves into trouble because they're, you talk to other athletes who had a lot of money, you know, and professional, and they just kind of wild out because they were young, they had money, and they didn't have that guidance. Mm-hmm. How was that for you? You were young, and here you were on this stage now, and here you were, you had this here contract. Tell me, who was Meek back then?
I wild out. First year.
What?
Oh, yeah.
I was like, that's a different kind of money. It's different, like, you gotta embrace that, though.
Yeah.
College. You know, you waiting on that Pell Grant.
I'm trying to say college is a hustle.
You waiting on that Pell Grant. When I got, it's so crazy. When I got my first endorsement check, I was endorsed with Nike. I was a Nike athlete.
All right.
Got my first Nike check.
That's big news.
Yeah.
That's a big deal. Yeah,
when I saw that check. Amazing. I was like, they had to have some of
this.
You know, but it's funny because no one taught me. Like, and my father.
Because it came a point, though, too, where now you got to a point where your father hadn't gotten to.
Right.
So now it's just like, dad, like, he's like, well, we got you probably got to figure it out.
And nobody I knew, nobody I knew personally could tell me how to manage from here.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It was like I was going through uncharted water. So yeah, the first year, you know, was crazy. I was buying whatever, you know, whatever I wanted to, you know, got a new car, you know, all the stuff that you
right.
But I reeled it in quickly.
Okay.
You know, I reeled it in quickly.
But what made you reel it in quickly? Because
some people don't have that.
No. Because you were still young.
Yeah. And I think it's I was blessed to be around a supportive group of women, like the vets on my team, the Deidre Charles, the Lisa Leslie.
Okay.
Like, they was like, you know, put some of that away.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or rainy, like, they would say stuff like that. You know, like, you know, don't spend it all.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, let me hook you up with my financial advisor.
Okay.
You know, let me set you up with an account.
Right,
like, they knew they had been in the game for seven, 8 years before I hit.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So they knew that this money is going to come and go.
Right,
Your window of opportunity with this money is you know, you only got.
Right.
No telling what you got.
Yeah.
You know, this could be a 3-year thing. This could be a 1-year thing. You know, you got to be able to manage that. And I sat down my second year with a financial advisor. And that's when I kind of got, it started clicking. You know, it started clicking then for me.
Wow. So Lisa was one of the groups that was overseas playing?
Yeah, and she had played overseas in Italy a few years.
Okay.
And the way it kind of happened was she was on that, I don't know if you remember, right before the WNBA hit in 96, they had that big, like, Olympic team. With they were everywhere.
Yeah.
They were like promoting them and blowing them up because they knew it was gonna be a WNBA here. So they took that dream, that Olympic team, and they promoted the crap out of them. You know what I mean? Just to get people ready to have some recognition of the players that were playing for when they played in the WNBA. So, like, she played a few years in Italy, and then she trained with the national team, which was the Olympic team, and did all of that hype and all of that, all of those tours and stuff with the Olympic team.
Okay.
So she had kind of been in the game for a little bit when I came around. And she definitely was one person that helped. Deidre Charles was another, and Penny Toler was another.
Okay.
Like, just kind of guided me.
Okay.
You know, just like, young blood, hold up. You can't be spending all your money like this. You gotta reel it in.
Now, how was the contracts for the women? Like, were they year by year? Were they, like, how did that work?
And people don't know. People think you coming out, you making all this money.
Right.
So, but the WNBA was running. It only ran for 5 months. So basically, I mean, it's a yearly contract, you're only getting paid a half a year.
Okay.
So what you doing that other budget. 6 months, you better know what you're doing with your
money. You got another hustle or you budget.
Exactly. Rookie contracts were like 40 grand.
Wow, what a difference though from the men and the women.
Rookie contracts, depending on where you were drafted now it's probably a little different.
Right.
Yeah, we talk about 97 back when So basically, I made most of my money to begin with on endorsement deals. My Nike deal was a six-figure contract.
Okay.
I did some stuff with Dark and Lovely early on.
Oh, look at that.
That was a nice little contract.
Okay.
So I was able to sustain that, and then also I played overseas in the WNBA off season where I made six figures. So I was able to, you know.
So you would leave here. Mm-hmm. Go overseas and play, and then come back and play the next season in the WNBA.
Right. Yep.
Wow.
Because you were only committed to your contract for 6 months out of the year. So basically, what are you going to do from the WNBA season ran from, let's say, April to September. And then, how are you going to stay in shape? Whatever you want to do, unless you're hurt or whatever, you know, you got to figure out what you're going to do between off seasons.
Now, did a lot of your teammates do that?
A lot of us did.
Okay.
A lot of us did. Some people stayed behind and worked internships and things like that to try to get their foot in the door for life after basketball.
Okay.
But I knew, you know, I was trying to train to get better the next year. So my progression was going overseas. So a lot of times I would be in Italy. I played 6 years in Italy. I played a year in Russia and I played a year in Turkey in between.
Wow.
Turkey was my first my first international experience, and I loved it. And then from there, I went to Italy and loved it. I stayed in Italy for 3 years. Then I went to Russia, and then did my last 3 years in Italy.
What was the difference? What did you love about playing overseas opposed to being here?
I was always a person that liked to experience other things, other cultures, and over there, they appreciate women's basketball. It was big. It's a big thing over there.
Right.
So for me, just to go over and experience that culture, be able to learn different languages, experience different foods and cuisines, and, just different people, create different friendships and relationships with people that I've played with over there and that I still maintain today. Those experiences, I think, you know, that you can't put a price tag on. So I think for me, that experience of going overseas, and then I wasn't scared of it because I seen my father do it.
That's right. You were exposed
growing up. So I was like, and he was the first person to actually tell me, you know, women over there playing good basketball. Even if there's not a league here, there's an opportunity for you to play overseas if you wanted to do that.
Yeah.
So I knew early on, that would be something that maybe I would want to try. And I fell in love with it.
What do you think?
Not to mention the money was good.
Well, okay. We're not going to not talk about the money. It wasn't something that you went over there and did just to volunteer.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely.
It wasn't just a good deed. But let's talk about just being in the WNBA, being a woman basketball player, and being someone who really kind of, catapulted, young ladies being able to see, I can play basketball as a career. It's not something that I have to stop now at college for those who may did not wanted to have gone overseas.
Right.
At what point did that kick in that, man, I'm a role model now, and people are looking at me, other young ladies are looking at me.
Yeah, I think early on too, I think the WNBA was like we made it a point to instill that in young girls. We were, you know, I signed numerous, I mean, I spent time with numerous people. I'm shaking hands, I'm stopped. I mean, I just tried to do everything I could to let young girls know that there's an opportunity, you know, for you. Now, you know, I think, you know, the girls coming out now kind of take it for granted because they didn't know what
without. It's been established, you know, for them.
They didn't know
a lot of
world
them before
without.
They were born.
So, you know, even when I speak to girls today that are entering into that next level, I try to let them know, you know, there was a time when this league was not, you know. And so you gotta, when you get in there, you know, you gotta do your part, you know, to move it forward, to keep it progressing. And part of that, you know, is to be that role model that you need to be for all of those young girls that are coming up behind you, to let them know that you can do this, you know. So yeah, I took that very serious even early on. And I think the league did a good job of trying to promote that too.
Right.
You know, we were very accessible.
Okay.
You know, a lot of times, you know, you go to professional venues and you can't get within 500 feet of the athlete. But we wanted to be, you know, present, you know, for people. We wanted to let people know, you can see, you can touch us, you can talk to us.
Right.
You know, kind of make it, give them that feel so they keep coming back.
Okay.
Now, there's a lot with the b-ball players now in college. They play, like, you know, better than some of the guys. Like, it's definitely the level of competition has room.
True.
But not everybody gets to that level. So, what do you think the biggest difference is? The difference is with, as far as, you know, the mentality of the ones that really want it, opposed to, you know, people that are just kind of like, oh, I'm just messing around. Like, what is the difference?
You know, I get that kind of question a lot, and you know, I get the question of, how come you made it? You know what I mean?
Like, why not?
What made you reach that level where so many people couldn't?
Right.
And, you know, I don't think it's something that can be, it has to be inside of you. Because when you get to a level, or when you're trying to get to a level that not very many people get to, you gotta be uncomfortable. You gotta do things that are uncomfortable. That might not be the norm. You gotta get out of that box.
That's right.
And you gotta try to create that uncomfortable feeling. The training, the whatever it is. I mean, for me, it was coming out of middle school 11, 12 o'clock at night, because I couldn't. I had this drill. I was just talking to my dad the other day, and there was this drill. Every time I trained, at the end of the drill, I would have to hit, and it's very easy, 12 baskets straight all around the court. So there's like six different baskets, two in a row. That was my job to in my training.
Okay.
Now I done trained for 3 hours now.
Right.
I'm ready to get out the gym.
Right.
And some days I would do this like that. 85% of it I would do it like that. And there would be some days where I would just struggle. And I'm a professional athlete. It was not my day that particular day. But guess what? If it took me 2 hours to do it,
see, that's the difference right there.
I'm staying in the gym. If I got the keys to the gym and they ain't gonna kick me out, you know, there is no I ain't doing. I can't sleep until I do.
You're right. That's gotta be in you, though. A lot of that stuff has gotta be great. I remember one time, because we lived in the same area one time, down Linden, and we used to see you and your father at the park sometimes, and sometimes you would be there by yourself. And we would just look sometimes, you know, because we'd probably be hanging out or something. And we just like, and I remember one time we had an argument, we were just like, she wouldn't be out here if her father didn't make her come out here. And we just like, but then we were just like, I mean, one time we seen you by yourself, and we was like, see, she out here, she out here. And then we couldn't believe it one time. And this is all, I'm just like, how do we remember this stuff?
Yeah.
We was like, she did a layup, but I think she touched the backboard. She ain't touched the backboard. And then she did, we was like, she touched the backboard. She was like, because it was a female
our age, a little younger.
Yeah. And you was, we were just like, she can play, she can play. But we was just like, we wouldn't come over there.
Yeah.
Because the way you was working out by yourself was like intimidating.
Yeah.
And God forbid you asked to play against one of us. We were gonna be like, no. So we were just like, let her go, let her go.
Yeah.
But it comes back to that, like, it was something that was in you. And we always say that's like the behind the scenes thing.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of time with the young people, they want the game day. They want the glitz and the glory.
Yep.
But it's those things that, you know, when you're at that court, when you're just like,
when
you
want to
quit.
On.
Right, right.
That's it. Mm-hmm. That is the key. When the lights aren't on, what are you doing?
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
What are you doing?
That's right.
Because
that's right.
You think you're going to get on the court, and just because
happen.
You show up, it's automatically going to happen. Mm-hmm. That's the difference between the kids now and me.
Yeah,
you know, it's not going to happen if you didn't put the work.
That's right.
Yeah,
you got to put the work.
That's right.
Yeah.
And then it turns on when the lights turn.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
But if you don't put the work in, you think you're just going to show up. You're going to get a mediocre play all the time.
Or you just think about it, the lights are on for you at all times.
Yeah.
And now when you get on the court, it's just everybody else can see it.
Absolutely.
You know, that's another way of even looking at it. It's not about, okay, because you'll see sometimes athletes, you know, their celebration dance and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. They focused on, you know, perfecting that.
Right.
And it's like, where's your skill set?
Right.
Mm-hmm. You get what I'm saying? Like, where's your hard work? We all talk about what you're going to do. You get the end zone and what you're going to do and all this stuff.
Yeah.
Where's your skill set at? You're probably not going to make it in the end zone.
Yeah.
But you're spending time on that.
Yeah.
See, when you see these professional athletes that practice their little dance or whatever, mm-hmm. trust me, that is a little bit of their practice that they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
They in that gym, they lifting weights, they running them drills, they doing all of that stuff because that's just what they do. But sometimes people look at TV and see the glamour part.
That's all they see.
And they want to look at the glamour and imitate the glamour and not understand the hard work and the sweat,
right.
The sacrifice it took to get to that point, even as a professional. Because you hear about LeBron and the Kobe's and all them ones, their work ethic is crazy.
Yeah,
and they're at the top of their game. Kobe retired now, but LeBron is at the top of his game.
Absolutely.
And you still hear about how his work ethic is. He's the first one maybe to come there and the last one to leave the gym. And he's the quote-unquote king.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So it's just, it is a mindset.
It's a mindset.
Yeah.
It's
but
a
some
mindset.
Of them, some of them see that end result, you know what I'm saying? And
that's
I think
what
time you was online talk about like Curry and how all of these guys think that they got a shot like Curry.
Yeah.
So that the mid-range is gone.
Yep.
Like Curry don't mess it up because this guy could, so everyone wants to shoot that. But you see at the young levels, they want to shoot threes and they just like, they can barely reach the rim.
Yeah.
And they want like, cause that's what Curry does. But this guy is special for one.
That's right.
But the
that's
amount
right.
of time that
that's
he puts
right.
into his craft
Absolutely.
Is crazy.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Like I shared a story all the time with kids when I talk to them because, you know, that I think that's the key that they need to be able to take.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully they get that,
mm-hmm.
you know, that
mm-hmm.
you can't do anything without putting the work in.
Mm-hmm.
But when I was, we had just, this was, I would say 2002. We won our WNBA championship that year too.
Mm-hmm.
But before that, the Lakers won theirs.
Mm-hmm.
And usually all the guys after that, you know, they on vacation, they with their family.
Right.
They take a month off and then they come back and get back into it. And we were starting to train for our season. So we were there early. The guys were just finishing up their season. And I remember this was a week after they won a championship.
Mm-hmm.
I got to the gym early, and I was telling you we share the same practice facility with the Lakers. Kobe in the gym. What are you doing? Mm-hmm. Y'all just won a championship.
Mm-hmm.
Like what?
Wow.
Like I gotta get better.
That's
like you
crazy.
You already know the target on our back. Like, I'm here. I'm hit a week later. Didn't take no time off. Back in the gym. Yeah, but that's what it takes.
That's
what it takes. I was always scared that somebody was working harder. I was always like, you're not going to show me out. If it's me versus you, I got to show you that I'm working harder. And it starts when nobody's watching. I got to make sure I'm on top of all the time.
What do you think the difference was when you came in the league and when you was getting towards the end of the league as far as your game? Because, you know, you come in, you're young, you get all this energy and all this stuff, and then you're getting older, you've been playing for some years, your body been feeling it for some years. How do you think you adjusted your game for, to, you know, to compensate for maybe, I don't know if you had knee issues or the different things
you
that come along?
The things just pop up as you get older.
For no reason. Yeah,
just 32, 33 years old, you just wake up like something, Achilles just sore for no reason. You're like, what in the world? But it's all cerebral. Like, as you get, you know, as you transition through your career and, you know, you become that wily vet. You know, now the girls, I remember, you know, coming to him and I was the rookie.
Right.
At the vets. And then, boy, just like that, you know, the tables turn and now they like, you the old lady. Hold up now. I still do y'all in at 33. But I think it's cerebral. You start to just, your understanding of the game comes through a little more. You know, you realize that, not that you wasted a lot of energy as a young athlete, but, you know, there were ways that you can obtain the same goal.
You're smart.
You have to be. What I mean? To compensate for, you know, their athleticism or whatever it is when you're young. You remember when you were. You know. But it's all, it becomes all cerebral. You know, you start to just think the game at a higher level, you know, and things come a little easier for you. But you can accomplish and obtain the same goal. Just getting to it in a different way.
How many total years have you played professionally?
I played 14 years professionally.
Wow.
13 years in the WNBA, and then I took a year off after I retired from the WNBA and went overseas one more year, and then called it a quit.
Now, what was that thing where you were just like, all right, it's time for me to let it go? You know, because an athlete, you know, and sometimes you don't know.
It's like,
Mike, why are you going to the Wizards? Mike, leave the Wizards alone. You know what I'm saying? When you got these young boys telling you, like, I want to do you dirty.
Your ego just won't let it happen.
He just talked about something with a rapper, and he was just like, you know, the heartbeats, when he show up, he still got the old suit on. And you just like, I still got it. But you gotta know when. But when was that time when you was just like, you know what, I'm gonna
For me, it was when it became hard for me to train.
Okay.
Like, to get up. Like, it never was hard for me to get up and put the work in. You know, to become better. And I always felt like I was chasing something every year. When I woke up and felt I wasn't chasing that, I knew it was time, you know. And it comes to a time where, you know, it just becomes like it became a job for me as opposed to it being a passion.
Right.
And so for me, that was when I was like, okay, you know, it's time for me to start thinking Plan B now, transitioning out of, you know, and into life after basketball. Yeah, when it was just tough.
Yeah.
You know, you start waking up, you're like, I go to the gym now.
Yeah.
Oh, I got, when that became hard, then I knew it was right. You know, it was time.
And you don't want to leave, and you just all jacked up. Yeah. Like, you
want to still have life.
Because I look at some athletes, and it's just like, man, I think they might have stayed a little too long.
It's a lot of
You know what I'm saying?
A lot of them. Like, I think I look at a lot of, you know, even former WNBA players that are just like, knees, backs, like tore up. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, man, I'm so blessed that I was able to, I walked away.
Yes, you know, walked away.
You know, now I complain about little things. But it ain't like, you know, I'm still up. I'm moving around and I'm, you know, I'm active.
Right.
You know, there's players out there that I think kind of, and it's hard as an athlete when that's all you've known all your life was being that. And then out, and then next step, you gotta transition out of that. It's like, it's scary and it's hard. It really is.
Wow.
So,
no, go ahead.
What about now? Let's talk about the transition from being an athlete to now. What do you put your energies into when you say, okay, the balling is over to the side?
Yeah.
What preparation did you take for life?
So for me, it was tough. It was a difficult transition for me because I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do. And still, I'm not in a position, even still today, and I've been retired since 2014. I'm still not, I still I have to kind of find that thing that drives me, you know, and I think that comes from being an athlete.
Right.
Coaching? You thought about coaching?
Thought about it. But now, do I want that stress level?
Yes.
You want to enjoy retirement.
Because
right?
It is a stress level.
It's a certain stress. And then you're dealing with the younger kids now.
It's a stress level.
Yes. It's a stress level. And then on top of that, you know, I think for me, I would be unfair as a coach because I'm gonna set the bar. I'm like, that might not be right for somebody else's child.
What are you home at 8 o'clock and you're 10 years old?
Yeah, I gotta make you 12 shots after graduating.
What are you talking about? Get out of here.
Yeah. So I don't know if coaching is that thing. But for me, the transition was very difficult because I was trying to figure out what, you know, what I wanted to do. I interned a couple of off seasons that I took off from, you know, going overseas just to kind of try to gauge. Because as an athlete, you know, you've done that all your life. You know, so when you come out, when I retire at 33 years old, I have no work experience at all. Like, what am I gonna do now?
Yeah.
I'm starting at 33.
Right.
Where everybody that I've known that came out of college is already into their careers and is selling, excelling. Because they've done that. They've been 13 years out.
Yeah.
You know, there. So you're kind of starting over. But I always knew I wanted to be an entrepreneur. I just kind of had to try to figure out my lane with that. So when I first got out, I applied because I thought I wanted to be a financial advisor.
Okay.
I applied with Edward Jones. I was accepted there, and I worked that for 2 years.
Okay.
And realized it wasn't kind of what I wanted to do. So I moved into something a little faster. I did insurance sales.
Okay.
Went straight into insurance sales, and I had a team of like 13 people working under me.
Okay.
Made it to like a management position.
Okay.
But then got burnt out from that, and I was like, man, I don't know. You know, I'm still trying to figure it out.
Right.
Now this
is
all like 2 or 3 years removed.
And
I'm still trying to figure it out. And then I kind of got into the car rental business from a friend who her family owned 10 of them.
Wow.
And I, you know, when I used to come home from college, she's a good friend of mine. We actually went to high school together before coming to Linden. We grew up all the way through the school system together. And she, her parents used to always talk to me about franchises.
Okay.
They had 10 franchises and they, you know, were looking to sell a few of them off and move down to Florida.
Yes. That's a great thing that you have options, and I think you'll always have that. I'm like, Deon didn't make it to the level of like NFL, but oh my gosh, he can never stop. Mm-hmm. Just from being an athlete since he was a young kid.
Exactly.
So he just kept on playing and playing. I always tell people, I was like, enough already with the playing football.
Yeah.
Your knees is jacked up.
Yeah.
You done had a million concussions. Like,
yeah,
enough already. And then you gotta go to work every day now. You
yeah
know what I'm saying?
That's
but
true.
He was still trying to do the football, flag football,
yeah,
all of this stuff. And then finally he was like, let me just stick to coaching.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I
was just like, knock it off already. You know what I'm saying?
But you know what? It gives you like sports, like you were saying, you know, if you do it the right way, it ain't just like when I tell athletes too, it ain't just the physical part, it's the mental part.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So when you're mentally into something,
absolutely,
you train yourself to be disciplined, you train yourself not to quit, you train. So when you're not doing that sport anymore, it's like, what am I doing with all of this?
Mm-hmm.
I still get up early in the morning for no reason.
Exactly.
See, like it's the weekend.
Exactly.
I'm just used to it. You know what I'm saying?
Sometimes I can't
turn it off.
Yep.
When I do something or when I see something, it's
right,
like it's hard for me to watch sports and not be objective.
Yeah.
I'm like, what's going on there? You know what I'm saying?
I can tell you some stories.
And that's Tame. He don't sound like that.
I don't watch. It's funny. I can't watch an NBA game without analyzing it. I'm like,
yeah,
what is he doing? You know, what are they doing? You know.
Call a timeout.
I'm that person too.
Yeah.
And I think it comes from just that athletic background.
Yes. It is crazy. Because, you know, my sons is not as, they played sports and everything, but they was never the same level of passion like he
right
was for his sports. But I'm going to tell you, what they are passionate about is arguing over the teams
right
and players and the whatever. Boy, they are
relentless.
Down. And my youngest one, Keon, is relentless with it.
Because he got that
because
phone. He's like, let me
phone
check that fact.
Yeah.
He's like, stats. And I'm just like
in right any minute, he'll be like, he'll say something, he'll be like, no, because in 2000. And then he'll be like, yeah, no, look. And they just be back and forth, back and forth. I'm like, oh my God. You would have thought that he played on the same level
right
as him.
Right.
But it's just the fact that he ain't going to be right and I'm not right.
Still
like
competitive.
I know that's right.
Competing.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
It's just like this whole, and it's crazy because it's this house full of testosterone. I'm the only woman in here. So I just sit there and smile and watch and I just say, I'm going to take all this in because they're grown now.
Right.
I don't know how much longer I have of having this kind of banter go on in the house. So to me, it's just like,
it's music to you.
Yeah, exactly. It's just music to my ears because
right
they'll be in different places of the house. And if he's downstairs, they'll run upstairs. Did you see that play? And then there's just this constant thing going on. But I love it, though. I love it. But I think, like you said, with you being a competitor, him being a competitor, I will never understand it on that level.
Right.
Because I wasn't an athlete through school. I didn't, you know, go to college and play sports and all of that stuff like that. And then he played a little semi-pro also. So
right
he just has that in there.
Yeah.
So I could only imagine what it must be like for you now. Even though you're not still in it like that, you're still Tamecka.
Yeah.
This basketball player that played
exactly
for years.
Exactly.
That doesn't go away.
It doesn't.
Yeah.
It doesn't. Sometimes I wish it would, but it doesn't. But I tell you, I think the intangibles that you learn, being an athlete, you know, if you played at any level, really, you know, these are intangibles that you could take with you in whatever
direction. It's just life.
Go
a lot of times, it's just life.
I mean, this is the reason why, you know, you got these companies coming
right
out. And if you say that you were an athlete or, you know, they search for those characteristics in people that they want to work for them.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, it's a reason for that because the discipline and the passion and the consistency that you have
to show. Yeah, you have to work together with other people
teamwork
as a team. Yes,
all those intangibles that you learn being an athlete, man, mm-hmm. I mean, you could take that anywhere with you.
So let's shift over to talk about Tamecka now. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about family life and just what's Tamecka, your family life, and just...
Life is beautiful now. Mm-hmm. Life is life is beautiful. You know, I'll be getting married next year.
Okay.
And thank you. Thank you. So, you know, that part of my life is kind of stable. Mm-hmm. You know, I'll be welcoming in a stepson and a little dog. So life is beautiful on that front.
Okay.
You know, and it's all coming together.
Okay.
You know, I think when the goal is to try to get all of those areas of your life, you know, to kind of mesh together and move forward in one direction. And I think I'm finally getting to a point where, you know, I'm getting that.
Okay.
I'm excited about it. I'm excited.
So we had a little comment from the popcorn gallery.
Okay.
Who said, life is good now. We had a little comment. Everybody, y'all can't see, but we had a little comment. We had to turn the camera around a little bit. We might have to turn the camera around. This will be the first time.
Behind the scenes.
No, but we know Quan, you know, and a beautiful woman.
Thank you.
Beautiful woman. We've been able to spend time, you know, with her as well, and you too, you know, as a couple. And just talking about that, just talk some of the challenges of the, what's the letters?
LGBTQ
community.
Yes.
Because Tamecka, that's big.
Yeah.
That's absolutely big. And just you coming through the league, or you know, coming through different places, what are some of the challenges that came along with that? Because let's just be honest, this has not been a lifestyle or just who you are that it has been accepted always.
Absolutely.
Has not been accepted always. And people have been treated really poorly as well.
Right. Well, I can say for me and my experience, the experience, first of all, for me, has always been positive because my family is supportive.
Okay.
So outside,
that's important.
If it starts there, and your family is supportive, you can kind of create your own bubble where nothing else really outside matters. Because the people that matter
at the
to
end
you
of the
most,
they gonna go their way.
Okay. So for me, my family has always supported me in that. So it made it easier for me, but my village is incredible.
Right.
They've embraced her and my family, and it's been nothing but love.
Mm-hmm.
But I've experienced, I've heard other horror stories.
Right.
People who don't have that support.
Yes.
And it's tough.
Yes.
You know, that is tough that you can't live your own truth
for fear that you will lose
everything around you that matters to you.
It's the truth.
And it happens quite often. You know, you look at the news now, you got, you know, all these young teenage kids because they... You know, they can't, they don't feel that support from home or whatever. They commit suicide.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
And, you know, I can't fathom that.
They're being bullied. In their own households,
In
their own households. Because a lot of families do not accept it. And I hear some comments from afar. I hear how people talk and they don't accept it. Or, you know what, I'm going to disown you. You know, it used to be back when the woman got pregnant and wasn't married, that families disowned you for just that.
Right.
Now it's, you know what, if you're not who I think you should be, I don't want anything to do with it.
Right, and it's crazy. Right. It's crazy, but what I could say is I'm so blessed, you know, that I have a supportive unit of people, a supportive family structure that has allowed me to be who I was. Mm-hmm. And I can't say it's always been this way.
Right.
You know, because we about to get real candid. But I knew very early on what I liked. But I think I had to grow into knowing that okay. and being comfortable
okay.
with that.
Okay.
Let me interject real quick, because this was something like, even like within the last year or something, that was with the WNBA.
Mm-hmm.
It was something coming out saying that they forced the culture of that.
Yeah.
Now, was that,
that
your experience in the WNBA?
Absolutely not.
Yeah, because they was like, they like, it was a culture and people weren't really like that. Mm-hmm. Then it was coaches and players that were forcing themselves mm-hmm. on people. But
I remember, because I kind of made, there was a kind of like a movement mm-hmm. from players that were like, didn't agree with what that one person said mm-hmm, that was coming mm-hmm. out and sharing their story.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, I don't want to undermine
or
belittle anybody's experience.
Right.
If you felt that
right.
But let me share mine so we can get more positive stories out there, but I didn't feel that. I don't know what her experience was.
Right.
But I didn't feel that at all. I mean, on all of my teams, you had men married, women married to men.
Yeah.
You had everything.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You had there wasn't just one thing.
Right.
You know, people are different.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
So, but. My experience was not that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there was really a culture of that. There's not very much talk about private lives mm-hmm. unless you're really, close to people in the locker room or whatever.
Okay.
Like, the Sparks were a sisterhood.
Okay.
So we were sisters.
Right.
So I shared everything with my sisters.
Right.
You know, they knew, we knew.
Right.
If you didn't, you didn't. If whatever you did, you
right.
did. But that's your private life.
Yeah.
All I care about is what you do on the court.
Right.
We coming to win this chip or
right.
not.
Yeah.
That was my thing. But
well, it's good that you guys had that.
Yeah, we
because
had.
Because in certain sports, mm. in certain, mm. you know, we had, I guess, Kasim Green.
Oh, yeah.
And he was talking about something like that.
Yeah.
He was like, he was just giving us the stats
that
in the locker room. You knew it was some gay guys there, but they couldn't talk about it at all. But at least, in your league, mm-hmm. people felt comfortable. Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It didn't interfere with their play. And the same thing with another sport, it won't interfere, but some people can't be who they really are because it's not accepted in the organization. And that could be coming from the top down.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think the women's league is really the only, women are the only, this is the only league that this is really targeted.
Oh, yeah.
Who really cares?
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, you don't really discuss it in the NBA. You really don't discuss it in the NFL.
Right.
But when it comes to us,
exactly. But let's go back to, because this one cut you off, because I know we had a
question. When I think of something, I forget it.
29 years, trust me, I know.
Let me say this.
She said something and you was like, but you know what? I'm like, but I know. He was like, I'm going to forget it, so let me talk about it. But what you were saying, you was comfortable. Like, you knew at an early age.
I knew very
You
early.
Knew early on. Did you feel like you had to play the part of, I need to date men, I need to date boys, because I know I feel this way, but I know I'm not really comfortable yet with that, so let me play the part that I'm supposed to play?
Yeah, I think I was young,
mm-hmm.
so I was kind of trying to figure it out mm-hmm. myself, too,
mm-hmm.
because I was having those feelings, but I was like, am I just having these, I don't know if this is a normal feeling
mm-hmm.
or not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I had to grow and develop into mm-hmm. who I was,
mm-hmm. before,
my comfort level.
Right.
I always knew, that I was, it wasn't, how do I say this? Like, how I felt wasn't socially acceptable.
Yeah.
Know what I mean? So.
Yeah.
I think from that standpoint, I hid it for a long time.
Okay.
And I didn't really talk about it mm-hmm. at all. Mm-hmm. I just kind of lived and tried to figure things out.
Right.
And then when I finally felt comfortable enough in college, you know, to say to my mother that this is what it is, my mom was like, I was just waiting on you.
Yeah, right.
The blessing in all of this is that I had a supportive family
that did not
berate me or belittle me because I felt that way.
Yeah, absolutely. And your dad, did your mom tell your dad, or did your dad wait for you to tell him? Because, you know, I know how men wait until he come and say something to you.
My dad is very, very, very laid back.
Okay.
Very. Mm-hmm. Like, just extreme.
Mm-hmm.
So when I told my dad that I was getting married, he was like, oh, really? That was it.
Oh. He's like, wait a minute, you mean just recently?
Yeah. He was like, oh, all right. Like.
So, but you've had to have discussions with him over the...
Really? He knew.
Right.
But it was just unspoken.
Yeah.
I never really just said, Dad, this is good. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I think that's with just like how men be.
He was like, now, my dad remarried. Okay. So my stepmom is more in tune. She's oh, he all right. You know, talked to her.
Right.
About his emotions.
Yeah.
He doesn't show them. You know what I mean? So I just had to make sure, like, he was okay with it.
Right.
You know, what he's saying?
Right.
He's like, oh, he's good.
Yeah.
You know, we talk about this all the time.
Yeah.
They have their pillow talk.
Yeah,
I never know what's going on. He's just very nonchalant. But I know he got my back.
Right.
Without a doubt.
That's incredible. And from you going through this experience, how do you think it impacts when you come across young ladies now, today, that I don't know if any of them like come to you or whatever the case may be, but how do you think it is with you being able to talk to them, you know, through, you know, or just listen to them or hear them or not? Because, you know, they're ostracized.
Yeah.
Even in 2000, you ostracized, you know? Like, how do you feel with you being able to have got comfortable yourself to help these young people to where they don't feel like they need to kill themselves or they feel like nobody's in my corner?
I mean, my door would always be open to that. I'm not around.
Okay.
A lot of young ladies, like if I was coaching or something like that, I would probably experience that a lot more.
Okay.
But my door would always be open to me and ear, because I think that's, you know, people just need that.
Yeah,
like,
oh my God.
You need that. Like, even for me, as a professional athlete, I would have never discussed it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, we talking about my endorsement deal.
Oh,
about,
yeah.
You know, you start thinking about that stuff.
Yeah,
and people would, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Maybe I can lose some of that if I speak my truth.
Mm.
So I never, you know, as a professional athlete, I kept it very neutral.
Yeah.
Very neutral. You know, now I can speak my truth now. But, you know, even like I said, just as an athlete, you know, and professional athlete, if I was still under contract, I probably wouldn't be having this conversation because of that.
Yeah.
You know, but now, you know, I'm free to, I would be free to talk. Because, you know, I hear the horror stories, and it's disheartening.
Yeah.
It really is.
Do you think, like, now in the NBA, they would have to still, WNBA, they would have to still keep quiet for that very same reason?
I think more players are coming out now than they have ever. You know, when I was in the league, in the early stages of the league, they you know, it's funny. We had our, what'd they call it? It wasn't LGBT back then. Mm-hmm. It was Pride.
Okay, yes, that's right, yes.
They would have their Pride game and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, the 60% of our fan base is probably LGBT.
Right, right,
know?
Right.
I would say half, maybe half. You know, they supported it.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and they took the WNBA took their dollars. and you know, they didn't have a problem doing that. So, you know, they should, you know, I thought,
right.
You know, they should have been more open. But I mean, they did a good job of, you know, doing that early on. Mm-hmm. But now, they do a lot more.
Yeah.
You know, a lot more than they did back then.
It's a much stronger force now. A whole lot stronger than what it used to be back then.
Absolutely.
In the 90s.
Absolutely.
My goodness.
It's like leaps and bounds now.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I think they do a decent job now promoting it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think it's a balance though, still, because you don't, you know, just because, you know, maybe 40 or 50% of your fan base is that, you still have to serve another part of your fan base too. So you don't want to alienate
anybody.
You know, anybody.
Yeah.
You know, everybody is welcome.
Right.
You know, but it's still a delicate balance.
Right.
You know, because you may have, you know, people who, you know, would not come to a game because their favorite player now that they just found out. You know, LGBT.
Right.
That's against my morals and values, and now I can't spend my dollars to come support you.
See, but this is my thing that I have with that. It's just because that's not you. And what you say your morals and values are, am I to treat you differently because of that?
That's
you get what I'm saying?
I love that.
Yeah.
Am I to treat you different because, well, that's not for me.
Right.
But you know what? I don't like you.
Right.
Because that's for you.
Right.
And my whole thing with that is, who am I to decide what is best for you?
Right. Exactly.
Judge you.
Exactly. I agree.
Tamecka's got to live in that body.
Michelle's
got to live in this body.
Exactly.
He has to live in that body. So why am I trying to control the trajectory of your life?
Right.
You get what I'm saying?
Oh, absolutely.
And that's just like with anything. I don't have to agree. You don't have to agree.
We can go back
and forth. But I'm going to love you for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm going to love you for you. And I think it's so hypocritical because I see people who talk like that. And it's like, well, you know what? That ain't right and they shouldn't be. And this and that.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, they want to preach love. Or they want to talk about love.
Right.
And my thing is this. Love is love.
Mm-hmm.
There is no discrimination in love.
Right.
There is no discrimination in love.
Absolutely.
So why not be okay with allowing that person to live their life and you live your life?
That's it.
But we want to harm.
Yeah.
We want to make your life horrible.
Yeah.
We want to make you feel bad.
Yeah.
And I can never understand that.
That's, I can't either. I can't either. I don't understand it either.
But I'm glad you, I know, but I'm glad your experience hasn't been bad. Like you haven't. Have you lost friendships or people that you thought were friends when they, see, that's a wonderful
thing.
Because I know of stories where.
Oh yeah, me too.
People drop off.
Me too, me too.
And society itself doesn't allow you to share your truth.
Yeah.
And a lot of times to me, it's like, it's healthy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, and one of the things that we had people that we've been talking about, one of the phobias or one of the taboo things was mental health.
Yes, yes.
You know, there's a lot of people, especially like with, again, with talking about athletes and the mind.
Yes.
It was things that I was just like, should I be like this? Should I be, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So, and it wasn't until recently, like, I tell people now, like, I see a therapist.
That's right.
You know, I have to just so that I'm clear on my thinking.
That's right.
But if you say that in certain areas or certain things, people are just like, you're crazy or you know what I'm saying?
Especially in our community.
What?
Man. You say you're going to a therapist? We'd rather have this person walk around the street, call them crazy Tyrone or crazy. No one needs therapy, but don't go.
Yep.
But we'll accept that, though, in our community.
Go in our house. Put them in the room.
Knowing that somebody's crazy.
Put them in the room.
We shame them for getting
help. Bring him a meal. Like, don't hold that soul.
You're going way back.
But it's the truth.
Yeah.
They wouldn't have made it like that in that movie if that's not how we act.
Yeah, that's true.
You get what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And it's a sad story because even with Deon's experience, I was like, Deon, you have got to go and talk to someone. You've got scars from your past, scars from growing up, your formative years as a child, there's things that happen in life, and you have got to talk to someone because it's impacting your adulthood 30 years, 40 years later, and you're still, you know, almost have like a post-traumatic stress from these things that's happened back then. Like, no, what are you going to tell me? I can do this too.
I actually look like that.
Now, that's my, this is my version. This is,
up as a character.
This is my story, and I'm going to tell you. Anybody who knows you know that you are not charismatic. You are really laid back. So they know that this is Michelle being Deon. But he was just like, no, you know, and I took a class in school and I could almost diagnose myself. I'm like, brother, if you don't go and see somebody and see what's going on. And
that was one of the best decisions
he made
ever.
It took a few years. Yeah. It took a few years because he would go, because I would ask him to go.
Right.
And then it was a bad experience. Yeah. So then it was like, I gotta see what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And then he went to someone else recently and it was a bad experience. And then last year, he found someone that he connected with. And it was just like, it opened him up so much.
Yeah.
Wow. So much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Yes.
But those is the areas in our community that we have to really, because I even think, you know, with the LGBTQ community, our community is the worst with that.
Yeah.
Our community is absolutely horrible with
that.
We are horrible. And I don't know exactly what it is that, I don't know if they do, it's like a knock on, like, I don't know what it is. It's like with mental health, it's like with that. It's like, what is it that gets us so enraged with that? I don't understand what it is.
I don't understand. I don't know either. Mm-hmm. But I know it is like our community, the shuns.
Yeah.
Especially the mental health thing. Not especially, I mean, both of them. But you know, I have, you know, my brother suffers from, he's obsessive compulsive, and he has bipolar tendencies. And then I have an aunt that's schizophrenic.
Okay.
So I've been able to experience some of those things on the ground level. With them, and it is a journey, you know, and you don't have a supportive family. Riding for you. You know, it's tough. You know, my brother, you know, he still lives with my father, my stepmom, and you know, he is 20. Deron is what, 25?
Okay.
And you know, he's now, he finally stabilized him and got him, you know, pretty good now where the medicine is
agreeing
with him and stuff
right
like that.
And he takes it regularly?
He takes it.
Because we have family members that don't take their medicine and then
Had issues with that. You know, they've had issues with that.
Okay.
But I think now, you know, he's doing pretty well.
Okay.
You know, but it's definitely a constant. You know, you have to have a supportive family.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, when you're going through that.
Yes.
Because even with a supportive family, you know, that person may be just as combative.
Yeah.
You know, and it's hard.
Yeah.
You know, you like this.
Yes.
You know, because they don't feel like they need that. Or, you know what I mean?
Yes.
So it's an everyday struggle.
Yeah, because we've had experience with that, you know, as well with family members, and they for them, they're okay without having it. And then an episode will come, you know, and then it's now having to start back over again because they stopped taking the medicine, now we got to get back in the system. And, you know, it's a process, but I think if we just learn to love people for just who they are, not what they can do, not how they can perform, not what they make me look like, you know, because we get so caught up in that, you know, are they going to make me look bad?
That is so
gosh, you know, Pookie needs love too. Like we're horrible.
comfortable with that.
Yeah,
and I just from you having the great experience that you have from your family and the village that you have, you could pour that into the next generation, because there's so many negatives of people who are not even here to pour it.
Right.
Because they have succumbed to violence because of who they are.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And it's just good to talk to you, Meek, and just hear your experiences have been so good in so many areas of your life.
Yeah.
And I think that impacts why you are the type of woman that you are.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You know, your gentle spirit.
Yeah.
You know, you're giving.
Thank you.
You're loving. You know, you're a great person to be around.
Thank
you. You know, and just because you were a great athlete, some people don't have that. Some people are great athletes and they have horrible dispositions.
Yeah.
They done made it to some levels and they nasty. People don't want to be around them. Like, oh my gosh, they're a great player, but oh, they're horrible, you know, as a person.
Right.
You know, but you don't have it. And I've never, ever heard anything negative about you.
Mm-hmm. That's a blessing.
Never heard anything negative about you.
That's a blessing.
You know, and I personally know you and spent time around you. Deon's known you longer.
Yeah.
He's a little younger than I am. When you came into high school, I was out of there. I was gone and whatnot. But just when me and him talked, and I was just like, he was like, we've got to get a female on the shirt. I said, I know. Hey, sitting here with all this testosterone around me.
You know what we do behind the bright lights, beyond the bright lights, is like we want people who will talk.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Because everybody knows me.
Yeah.
Everybody, you know what I'm saying? But what we found out is people get in certain positions, right? And the things that the pitfalls and the things that they've been through that could help another person, they don't want to share.
They don't want to share.
But you've been through what you've been through, so somebody else could benefit.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
So that's why we like to have conversations and dialogue with people who are just real.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? That that all right, I've been through this. And then personally, when you get a certain age, you're like, I don't care. What you know what I'm saying?
That's
where I'm at. That's I'm ready to just sit down and I think it's highlighting coming home on Friday.
Exactly.
And just be like, okay.
That's
you know what I'm saying? So it's like, why not? What I've learned or I've been through, let me share
that's
these gems with somebody
that's
else.
Right.
Let me, you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
So many people don't want to do that.
That's,
and that's where dysfunction comes in.
Yes.
Because these young kids, they smart. They know that.
Mm.
You know something about that.
Mm.
You know. Yeah. But we just, no, we don't want to talk. That's how when my mother, she's like, don't want to talk about nothing.
Yeah.
But that's where they came from.
Come
they were just
on
like
down. That
closed in and they don't want to talk
what
or whatever.
In my house. Yeah,
that's
what I'm saying? My house.
Yeah.
What?
And that hurt us.
Absolutely.
That hurt us a lot of times.
Yeah. Even with stuff like finances and stuff, like there's so many gems that like your parents could have shared with you that would have taught you.
Going to college, getting those credit cards. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, those places are out there, those credit cards. Let me give you this thermos right here.
We had to think ourselves about it.
Let's get this credit card.
Oh my God. What?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Financial literacy.
Right. And just even the parents sharing if they didn't have the money for something or whatever and stop instead, some parents would just not talk about we have to pay these bills, this, this, and that, so we can't do such and such. It was grown folk.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And whatever. And we would be like, all right, you know, we don't have the money for this, but we had the money for that.
Right.
Or, you know, mom got income tax check.
Yeah.
I was part of that group of let's go.
Yeah.
We got our income tax check when we was younger. Now I tuck it away, but well, now we don't have one. But basically,
you
gotta thank this new presidency for that.
Oh, that's
we don't have one.
That's not, we could be here all night.
What are you talking about? What do you mean we don't have that kind of money? We ain't in the top 1%. What the heck is that?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I just think about that. We talk to our young men about so many things.
Right.
So many different things, because we want them to understand when they become parents or they have spouses or whatever the case may be, they know what to do.
Exactly.
You know, they won't be dependent upon anybody. They won't be out there flailing, trying to figure it out, but they'll know what to do. And we told them the truth.
Right.
Yep. We were honest with them.
Yep.
We didn't try to pretend anything.
Yep.
It is what it is.
Absolutely.
And because you did that, they're gonna be all right. They're gonna when they see it, they'll know what it is.
And I used to say,
you
Meek,
shield them from.
I just want to live to see them to be, but not just one of them. Let me live to see them to be 18 or you know older. So I'll see how they are as young men. They'll be able to take care of themselves,
mm-hmm.
and then you know, now it's like, I just want to live.
Yeah.
Now I got to the point where Travis 29 and Keon 24. Right. So I was like, I just want to live.
I hear you.
I just want to live at this point. But we get to see what type of young men they are, like right now. So we're like, you know what? You know, if God was to close my eyes today, those boys are going to be okay. Because we see it, you know? And they take care of one another. Right. And they're not selfish.
Right.
Just all of those characteristics that I don't like.
Yeah.
You know, they are not that.
Right.
You know? Now, one is a little bit more given than the other. But one is a little bit more given than the other. But they both have that about them.
Right.
And that's a beautiful thing, because if they were just horrible young men out here impregnating all types of women, coming home high every day, not working, not in school, not doing anything.
Right.
It's like, oh my gosh, what are they going to turn out to be? Mm-hmm. I mean, for one, they wouldn't be living in this house. That would be clear real quick. It's like, me and daddy about to live and party. Y'all
that's
there
right.
wanted to do that, then I'm sorry, we about to move on. Y'all are grown now. We ain't worried about it.
Yeah.
But you know, those are some concerns that you have, you know, as parents, or, you know, seeing your kids when they get older. You don't want them to be jerks.
Sure.
You know, basically, you don't want them to be jerks.
Yeah.
But
absolutely.
This has been a pleasure,
man.
Yes.
It's been great. We touched on the whole
thing. Yes. Oh, this has been a pleasure.
Absolutely.
I am so glad you came and shared your time with us, me.
We got to do a part two.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
After the wedding.
Yeah. Uh-oh, we got to include somebody.
Yes, let's do that.
Awesome.
Do you
have a
good
boy?
No.
Yes.
You do?
Next year. Destination?
Okay. No.
Or, okay. All right. She ain't gonna say the date so people be like,
you ain't invited.
Oh God, that's a whole nother.
Listen.
Yes.
But we're gonna come to a conclusion, and unless Mr. Man has any more things to say.
That's it. I mean, it's been a great talk. It's been good, and this is like, you're like family,
though.
So it's not even like we always say these things here. You know, the proper term is interview, but it's just like talk.
That's it.
You know what I'm saying? And we love learning from people, and we love sharing their stories.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
With people out there, so they can kind of be, you know what I'm saying, inspired and motivated by what they hear.
And like Deon said, we sit and we think about who we're going to have, because we don't want to have people just because they have a platform.
Right.
We want to have people who are going to be real, who's going to be honest, and who's going to share their story.
Right.
Because we could Google what Tamecka Michelle Dixon did.
Yeah.
We could Google all those things.
Absolutely.
But the true story of who you are and how you became who you are, it's only a story you can tell.
Absolutely.
And that's the story we want to hear.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for your time, Ms. Meek.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Yes.
Pleasure to be here.
Yes. So with that being said, we are ending episode 5.
Episode 5.
With our special guest, our special friend,
Miss Tamecka Dixon.
Tamecka Michelle
Dixon.
How you forget Michelle?
All right, guys.
Peace.
See y'all later.